Good morning, new creation. According to John 4:23, it says, "But the hour cometh, and now is here, when the true worshiper shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. Come and worship him. Be a true worshiper, a free worshiper." Worship, Lord, I'm free. Lord, I'm free. Free to dance and sing. Free to lift my hands and worship. Lord, I'm free. Lord, I'm free.
Free to dance and sing. Free to lift my hands and worship. Lord, I'm free. Lord, I'm free.
Say free to dance.
Free to dance and sing, free to lift my hands and worship. Lord, I'm free. Lord, I'm free. I'm a free worshiper. I'm a free worshiper. I'm a free worshiper. Lord, I'm free. I'm a free worshiper. I'm a free worshiper. I'm a free worshiper. Lord, I'm free.
Free to dance.
Free to dance and sing. Free to lift my hands and worship. Lord, I'm free. Lord, I'm free.
Say free to dance.
Free to dance and sing. Free to lift my hands and worship. Lord, I'm free. Lord, I'm free. I'm a free worshiper. I'm a free worshiper. I'm a free worshiper. Lord, I'm free. I'm a free worshiper. I'm a free worshiper. I'm a free worshiper. Lord, I'm free.
I thank God I'm free. And I'm never bound again. I thank God I'm free, and I'll never be bound again. Come on, say I thank God.
I thank God I'm free.
Hallelujah.
And I'll never be bound again.
Claim it. I thank God I'm free.
Thank God I'm free, and I'll never be bound again.
Come on, I thank God I'm free.
I thank God I'm free, and I'll never be bound again.
Say, I thank God I'm free.
I thank God I'm free. I'm a free worshiper. I'm a free worshiper. I'm a free worshiper. Lord, I'm free. I'm a free worshiper. I'm a free worshiper. I'm a free worshiper. Lord, I'm free. Lord, I'm free. promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
And you are
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
He's a healer, yeah. Good morning, new creation, and all our visitors that are watching this morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. God is good, and He's been good all the time. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good, for His mercy endureth forever. Thank the Lord for being here this morning on this first Sunday of November. And thank God for He brought us down throughout the many months that we've been going through up to this time. But we come this morning, we come this time to have the Lord's Supper, and we've come to partake of it and to just have fellowship one with another. So as we come for His presence this morning, we just want to magnify His name and give Him all the glory and all the honor and praise that is due to Him. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Let us have a word of prayer before we go forward. Father God, we appreciate You. For Lord, it is because of Your grace and mercy that You allowed us, Lord, this opportunity to come before Your presence this morning. We thank You, God, for sending Your Son, Jesus, who gave His life on Calvary's cross, shed His precious blood, that we can have a right to the tree of life, that we can be saved, Lord, and that we can, Lord, serve You, Lord God, in our bodies and in our spirits. Most of all, God, we ask that You forgive us of any sin we may have committed, Lord. For Lord, we don't want to partake of this supper unworthily, nor have any malice or anything, oh God, that will keep us, oh God, from receiving Your blessings. So Lord, we ask that You forgive us, Lord, for any wrong that we have done. And we pray, God, that You be glorified and lifted up. In the precious name of Jesus, we ask, oh God, that You have Your way, Lord, in our lives. And we pray, God, that You use us, oh God, in Your service. We say thank You, we praise You, and we glorify Your name. We ask it in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. Thank You, Lord. For Lord, we pray, God, that You bless this sacrament. We pray, God, that You bless, Lord, the juice. We pray, God, that You bless, hallelujah, the bread, oh God, as we take it in remembrance of You, of what You've done, oh God, that we can have that fellowship with You, Lord. We thank You, God. Bless it right now. Have Your way, Lord, in Jesus' name. Thank You, Lord. Well, we praise God for this opportunity to partake of this Lord's Supper. Some call it the Holy Communion. As we commune together, some of you may not have the sacrament, but that's all right. If you have some juice or even water, you may take it. Or if you have a cracker, you may break it and take part of it. Whatever you do, we're doing it in remembrance of Jesus, what He did on the cross. He gave His life for you and I. Thank You, Lord. Praise Your holy name. The Lord's Supper is for those of you who have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, number one. Even if you have a child that has accepted Jesus as his or her Lord and Savior, they are more than welcome to join in this particular communion service. But for those parents, for those who are not saved, those, if you have any children who are not saved, we ask that you use this particular moment as a teaching lesson for your children, that they may come to know the purpose and the meaning of this Holy Communion, or some refer to the Lord's Supper. Amen. As we go to the Word of God, And if you have your sacraments before you at this time, we'll go to 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 23. Paul said to the Corinthian Christians, starting at verse 23, he says, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. When he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." You may eat. After the same manner, also he took the cup, and when he had supped, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my body. This do ye, as often as ye drink it, in remembrance of me." You may drink. Let me get mine here. Well, he also went on to say this. He says, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup." Verse 29 says, "For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinks damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. We got to check ourselves. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world." May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and to the hearing of his holy word. Let us pray. Father, we thank you, God. We thank you, oh Lord, for being able to have this Lord's Supper this morning, this time. We thank you, God, for again saving us, oh God, by shedding your precious blood on the cross. It was a great price, oh Lord, but it was because you loved us so much. We thank you, Lord, and we praise you. We pray, God, that you bless your people everywhere. We pray, God, that you continue to protect them, oh God, from any hurt, harm, or danger. Be a fence around them, Lord. We pray, God, that you meet each and every one of their needs. We pray, God, for our sick and our shut-in. We pray for our seniors, Lord. Those who are going through, Lord, different infirmities, different sicknesses in their bodies, God. We pray, God, that you lay your hands upon them, oh God, in the name of Jesus. And those, oh God, who are struggling, oh God, who are going through, Lord, these times of trials and troubles in their lives, we pray, God, that you bless them, oh God, in the precious name of Jesus. So many have lost loved ones, oh God. We pray, God, that you, Lord, comfort, console their hearts. We pray that you give them the strength to go through this time in their lives. And continue, Lord, to lead and guide us. You direct our paths. Help us to seek you first, oh God, in all that we do. And that we make you, God, please, oh God, that you can, we hear you say one day, Lord, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant." So, Lord, we say thank you, God. We thank you. Bless the service. Bless our pastor. Continue, the Lord, to bless him. Continue, the Lord, to use him, oh God. Speak through him, oh God, the word that you have given him in the name of Jesus. Bless his family, God, as they continue to be with him. Continue to protect them, oh God. We praise you, God. We praise you. We praise you. And we magnify your name. Father, we ask these blessings and all other blessings in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. We ask it in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
And Jesus said to his disciples, "Go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation." Proclaim not just to his sons, but to his beloved daughters. Not just the privileged few, but to the entire human race. To the whole creation, to all the colors and creeds, for God so loved all of us. How then can one daughter be more worthy than another? One son be more deserving than his brother? One color be more beautiful than all the rest? For it is written that no one can number his children. They will come from every nation. They will come from all tribes. They will speak all languages. And with their mouths, they will sing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." Therefore, we are all created in his image, not just a certain few. We are all adopted. None of us are his by birth. And we all must find the way, the truth, and the life. We all need Jesus. Jesus the martyr. Jesus the poor man. Jesus the prisoner. Jesus the teacher. Jesus the prophet. Jesus the resurrected. Jesus the first and the last. He is the creator of diversity, the author of equality, the defender of the defenseless, the one who breaks the chains of slavery, the one who continues to fight for freedom. He is the Messiah. He is the risen King. He is our only hope. Jesus, the Savior of the world. Jesus, the one who died for all.
Good morning, new creation! Oh, it's a beautiful morning this morning. I felt like a little bit of this song in my spirit this morning. And I just want us to sing a little bit of it, because I know he's sweet. I know somebody knows it with me. Come on, sing it with me. Just sing a few bars with me. Come on, sing it.
He's sweet. I know.
Can anybody testify to that this morning?
Storm clouds may rise. COVID winds may blow. Doesn't matter, 'cause I'll tell the world.
Hallelujah, this morning.
Wherever I go,
somebody's feeling that with me.
That I have found a Savior,
and he's sweet. I know. Let's do that one more time. Come on.
He's sweet. I know. He's sweet. I know.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
He's sweet. I know.
Anybody feel that this morning?
He's sweet.
Yes.
I know.
Oh, come on, give God some praise this morning. God is so good this morning. I just felt that in my spirit. He's sweet. Sometimes you just need to hear some of them spirituals, some of them hymns, because they bring us, they take us back. Take me back, dear Lord, to the place where I first received you. And so good morning, New Creation Outreach Ministries. Once again, it is good to be back with you as your pastor. We took a little time off last week, and we're back. Edith did a wonderful job. Praise God. And beloved, as we get going this morning, I want to welcome our first-time guests. I want to welcome our mission family in Thailand. And we always want to welcome back in our digital community family who tune in with us every week from different places around our nation. God bless you for that. And beloved, we are starting a new month and a step closer to the end of 2020. Wow, what a year filled with unprecedented, my beloved, challenges. A pandemic that's starting to feel like the virus of the early 1800s that devastated an entire world with millions dying. My God, my God. And church, this has been a year like none other that I've seen in my 60 years. Racial and social discord, weather, all kinds of weather phenomenon, fires, economic hardship, confusion, corruption all around us, sin all around us. And I dare say, my beloved, that we all have to continue to pray every day, all day, for our leaders, our leadership, and our government leaders. We got to pray for them all day long, my God. And to our first-time guests, my beloved, we are New Creation Outreach Ministries. We are a kingdom-focused church. A kingdom-focused church, my beloved, it simply means that we are a Bible-teaching church, that we are an equipping church, that we're a missional-minded church. Missional means evangelistic. And there are three centrals that we never deviate from that keeps us focused on our purpose as a church, and that is that we share the gospel, we transform lives, and we serve. Those are the three things that we never get away. We don't have programs here. We don't have pastors' appreciations here. We don't do any of those things that keep us from our focus, sharing the gospel, transforming lives, my beloved, and serving. And so we are glad that you are tuned in with us this morning. And beloved, before we go any further, I want to say a happy birthday and a happy anniversary to all our birthdays for the month of November, all our anniversaries, husbands and wives, for the month of November. We want to say again, happy birthday and happy anniversary. And church, let me say this while I'm thinking about it. COVID-19 is growing. It is a weed that is continuing to grow. It is very present. And as we are now in the winter months, my beloved, what I want to say to you is that we're going to continue to do, I'm going to continue to do as your pastor, what you guys have shared with me and conveyed to me, and that is your willingness to just continue to do ministry as we are doing them, because we know that we've been doing great things. All our ministries are thriving. We are doing a great job in a very difficult situation. And so we're just going to continue to stay safe and just pray one for another, because this thing is continuing growing, because simply people are not going to listen. People are not going to follow instructions. And so what we're going to continue to do based on your feedback to me is pray, stay engaged, and continue to love one another. Amen. And to our first time guests this morning, we are concluding a mini series that we titled Zion's Hill or Capitol Hill, to whom and whom do we trust. And so, my beloved, when we started this series, we talked about the issues of money and power and turf wars in our Congress. We've been talking about that. We've been looking at the body of Christ and government, especially in the times that we are living in right now, and these unprecedented times with an election coming up in two days. And so, my beloved, we've been dealing with some things. We noticed that the importance of what the Word of God, not the Word of God, but what the Word of God does say, according to Malachi 2 and 10, and what it says here, e pluribus unum, out of many, one. And again, the passage that we're talking about here that ties to that, Malachi 2 and 10. Do we not all have one Father? Oh, my God, I know we don't act like it. Did not one God create us all? And, beloved, as we go into this final teaching today, you're going to hear some of that echo. And so, new creation, you heard me echo. This teaching was prompted by the upcoming election, an election, my beloved, which will be of epic importance, none like we've ever, an election like we've never seen before, had before, because of the strife, all the turmoil, all the conflict and confusion this country is facing. My beloved, I would say our country and the world is in trouble. We are in trouble. And so, my beloved, you've heard me say it hundreds of times over and over again. This series was prompted. I did it 9 years ago, but it was prompted for me to come back with it because, again, it is the role of the church. It's the responsibility of the church, my beloved Mama Pat, that when things are going on, it's the church's responsibility to do what? Speak to the times. You guys have heard me say that hundreds of times. It's the church's responsibility to do what? In the midst of travail, in the midst of calamity, bring about a peace, bring about an assurance through the counsel of the Word of God. And so, my beloved, I was prompted, we were prompted to come back and teach this thing again on an issue that the country is facing. And so, church, this morning, we're going to conclude this series with a final subject: kings, kingdoms, and God. Somebody write that down. Kings, kingdoms, and God. And so, my beloved, 2 weeks ago when I was last with you, we talked about the issue of voting. And these are just the four teachings that we had in this series. We started out with Thine is the Kingdom and Power, part one. Then we moved into How Firm a Foundation, part two. 2 weeks ago, we taught on how should we live. How should we vote and how should we live? We vote the Bible. And today, my beloved, kings and kingdoms and God, Father God, my beloved. And so once again, as we get going today, John and Jackie, with all that's happening in our world and nation today, we, my beloved, are living in a time of kings and kingdoms, government systems, somebody write it down, that have rejected our Savior. That have ignored our Savior. And new creation, here's the one thing that the church, we must have clarity about. Kings and kingdoms are not the answer. Hallelujah. Somebody say amen. Beloved, it is God. Let me say it again. It is God who provides success to the nations when they follow him. The scriptures tell us that. It is also God who brings down nations. Hallelujah. When they reject him or disobey him. And so, my beloved, we found all that out. We've taught all that. We presented all that to you in the few weeks we've taught. And my beloved, the problem is there are sadly hundreds and thousands of people who reject God today. They don't believe God. Think about it. After 8 months, my beloved, of a virus killing over 1 million folks, we are still fighting about wearing a mask. We are still fighting about being sensitive and caring one for another. After 8 months, it's unbelievable that after 8 months, people are still dying because we refuse. That's just systemic of what's wrong with the world today. We're living in kings and kingdoms. We're dealing with kings and kingdoms who reject God, who have no respect for God, who don't believe God, who don't want anything to do with God, my beloved. And with that, it's time for us to review our final roadmap and learning for this teaching, my beloved, today's outline and challenge points. And so as we get going here, again, this was 2 weeks ago, we looked at how should we live? We vote the Bible. And I'm not going to get into that today. You can go online and check it out. But anyway, we're going to get into today. And we ask that question, does Father God sanction, approve, or support politics or political parties? And we have broken that thing down. But today, kings, kingdoms, and God. Notice it says here, in God we trust. My beloved, we're getting ready to get riding today. And here's our teaching outline today. We're looking at kings and kingdoms. They are not, somebody's typing in the chat, they are not God. God is God. Everybody's going to get that this morning. God is God. We're looking at the nations and governments. What do they have to do? They must answer to God, Father God. We're going to see that today. We're going to look at in Israel in the first chapter of 1 Samuel. We're going to look at Israel's downturn. They demanded a substitute for God. We're going to see that today, my beloved. And we're going to see that when they turn from God, they turn to kings and kingdoms. Many of you know this teaching in that. And then we're going to give you a final thing today for us to go out of this teaching to say that God has one king. We have one king. The church has one king. God, Zion's heel. We're going to give you the ecclesiastical authority. Our authority comes from God, Father God. And so, my beloved, let's continue on. Let's look at our learning objective in this final teaching. When kings and kingdoms, that is, governments, act or create laws that contradict or deny the Bible, the church has one choice. What's that choice, my beloved? To tether ourselves to the Word of God. The church is governed by and submits to the ecclesiastical laws of the Word of God. We don't follow kings and kingdoms. We don't follow the government when the government goes against the Word of God. The church's allegiance is to Father God. We want to make sure that we understand that out of this teaching today. What else do we want to get from the PowerPoint wisdom key today? Listen to me now. Any government, somebody type it in the chat, any government or constitutional system that ignores or rejects the Creator and the Bible will not work. Kings and kingdoms do not work because of a number of ungodly, greedy and corrupt persons who are unwilling to do what? Serve and minister. We've been talking about it. What's wrong with our Senate and the House of Representatives? What's wrong with our Congress? Can't get along. It has to be an us against a them, a we against a them, a left and a right. And when we have folk that's supposed to be representatives for representing us that we voted in, and they are getting up, they are tied to just foolishness, my beloved. Foolishness. Government will not work. It's not working. Look up here. Psalms 9 and 17 says, death is the destiny of the wicked. Oh my God. But all the nations who ignore or reject God. You know what that means? Kings and kingdoms that reject God? Death, he says, is the destiny. What else are we going to get at? What's the big question today? We got a few questions here today as we close out. Who has the authority, the sovereign authority and power over the nations of the world? Who do y'all think has the sovereign power and authority? We already told you that in week one. Who has the ecclesiastical authority over the church? Can kings, kingdoms, governments tell churches what they can and cannot preach? Oh, my beloved. Who or what the church has to accept? Can kings and kingdoms, governments tell us who we can preach, who we can accept? Look up here. Can kings, kingdoms, governments tell the church what we are to believe? No, my beloved. Not when it conflicts with the Word of God. Job 34 and 13 says, who chose God to rule over the earth? Oh, don't you love the Bible? Who was there to put God in charge of the whole world? We all know the answer to that. Nobody. God was there. Only God. Oh, my beloved, as we get going today, we're not going to be long, but we definitely want to make sure that there's some understanding as we move, Lord, in this time. And in our final teaching this morning, we're going to note it is God who is sovereign and in charge of kings and kingdoms, governments. God, my beloved, is in charge. And the church needs to live like that. The church needs to act like that. Somebody say amen. My beloved, I want you to know in Africa, in Asia, in all around Europe, planet Earth, none of the kings and kingdoms are God. God is God. God is God. Somebody type it in the chat. God is God. That's what we have to get. We don't live that way. The world is rejecting. Terry and Sister Francis, listen, here's the thing that I'm trying to get us to understand this morning. We don't bow down to kings and kingdoms because kings and governments will never be the answer to COVID-19. We don't bow down to governments because government will never be the answer to evil and sin. Government will never be the answer to health care. Government will never be the answer to the needs of the people. No. That's reserved for Father God. Oh, somebody say amen this morning. Hallelujah. And so, my beloved, the only answer that we want to make sure that we dial in and hone in on this final teaching, my beloved, is the answer is Father God. And church, our final teaching again is coming from the 8th chapter of 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel, many of you are very familiar with this passage. This is a passage of scripture where Israel made some just dumb decisions. Dumb decisions and choices. And so, my beloved, I want us to go right on over again to 1 Samuel, the 8th chapter. And I'm going to begin reading with starting at verse 1 through 8. I want everybody to get over there. I'm going to give you a moment to get there in your Bibles or your phones or your iPads, whatever one you want to use. It's okay. It's the Word of God. Hallelujah. We'll give you about another 10, 15 seconds, and then we're going to start reading. I'm going to start reading at verse 1 to see what Israel did as it relates to kings and kingdoms and God, our subject today. All right. Follow along with me, my beloved, as I read. Look what it says in verse 1, and we're going to read just eight verses, and then we'll stop. Look what it says here in verse 1. When Samuel grew old, he appointed his sons as judges over Israel. His firstborn son's name was Joel, and his second son was Abijah. They were judges in Beersheba. Look at verse 3. However, his sons did not walk in his ways. No, they did not. Many of us know that. They turned toward dishonest profit. They took bribes and they perverted justice. Sounds familiar to me. Hallelujah. And look at verse 4. So all the elders of Israel gathered together and went to Samuel at Ramah. Look at verse 5. They said to him, look, you are old and your sons do not walk in your ways. Therefore, appoint us a king to judge us the same as all the other pagan nations. Oh my God. Are y'all picking it up already? I know some of you who know your Bible, you got it already. Look at verse 6. When they said, give us a king to judge us, Samuel considered their demand wrong. And it was wrong. Look what the Bible tells us he did. So he prayed to God. Look at verse 7. But the Lord told him, listen to the people and everything they say to you. Why? Because they have not rejected you, Samuel. They are rejecting me as their king. Are y'all getting it already? You're starting to get it, huh? Look at verse 8. They are doing the same thing to you they have done to me since the day I brought them out of Egypt until this very day, abandoning me and worshiping other gods. Oh, my beloved. That is just so rich right there, the things that we can take from this, from these verses, my beloved. And so, my beloved, let me give you the background here. You guys have read it. We can see it clearly. The leaders came to Israel, Dre, to Samuel on behalf of Israel to complain and make their desires known. And notice what the Bible tells us. We read it. They told Samuel, we demand a king. We demand a king. And then they gave Samuel some justification. They told Samuel, Pastor Samuel, you are old. We don't believe in you anymore. You are old. We can't follow you anymore. You're not sufficient for the job anymore. This is what they said. They were saying. And the next thing they did, they told Samuel what was partly true. They said, your sons are some corrupt folk. They have perverted justice. They have taken bribes. They have been crooks. They haven't been like you been to us. And so we don't want them either. We're not going to follow them either. And Keith and Dorothy, the Israelite leaders standing there in front of Samuel, so what they were saying, we don't want you and we don't want God either. That's what they were saying, my beloved. And what did they mean by that? We demand. And here's somebody write it in the chat. Here's what they were saying. We want a substitute. We want a substitute. Somebody type it in the chat.
a substitute. There is no substitute for God. Imagine crying out and telling God, well, we don't want you. We want a substitute. We want to put somebody in your place. We want to put a king, somebody else in your place. Oh, my beloved. And beloved, let me say it here now. There was some merit to what they were saying to Samuel from the standpoint of they were concerned about their enemies. They were concerned about the government. They said, we need a stronger government. Because they were looking over at Samuel's sons, just kind of like we can look. I look up there on Capitol Hill and, you know, just pay attention to some of the nonsense. We get some of the stories about how some of them are taking bribes and they're crooks. And so there was some merit, my beloved. Rose, Mama CJ, there was some merit to what Israel leaders were saying to Samuel. But here's the problem. It wasn't anything to do. It wasn't that it was wrong for them to want to have better protection where their enemies concerned. It wasn't anything wrong with wanting a stronger government. But the problem was, here it is now, the sin was forgetting God and rejecting God. And the sin today, my beloved, you heard me say it a few moments ago, the sin is rejecting Father God. Oh, my beloved, the sin is rejecting Father God. And here's what I want us to understand. Men, the kings and kingdoms of this world, governments of this world today, they do not work. And they do not satisfy for one reason and one reason alone. Because kings and kingdoms aren't God. God is God. Somebody need to get that right there. I want you to pay attention. Let's go back to the outline because I want us to make sure. See, we're tracking with this outline. We're looking right here. We're looking. Here it is. There it is. Kings and kingdoms are not God. God is God. And we have to understand that about living in this perverted world, my beloved. And they were sitting up saying, oh, my goodness, we want a God. We want a king. We want to be like the rest of the world. We want to be like the rest of the pagan nations. We don't want to follow you. Samuel, we don't believe in you anymore. You're old. And so, my beloved, as we continue to move on here today, what I want us to understand right here, we got to stop right here because there's some things that we got to understand. And I want you to understand right here. They wanted a substitute for God. But listen to the Spirit of God in your pastor this morning. My beloved, there is no substitute for God. Look up here at these scriptures. See, kings and kingdoms are not God. God is God. Proverbs 19 and 21 says, many are the plans in the mind of a man, but it is the purpose of the Lord that'll stand when it's all over and said and done. Is anybody tracking? What's that mean? Nations and governments are not the answer. God is the answer, my beloved. Let's keep riding. Look up here. Psalm 33 and 10 through 10 and 11 says, the Lord brings the plans of nations to nothing. Oh, somebody's got to get this morning. God brings the plans of nations to nothing. He wrecks, the Bible says, the plans of the people. The plans of the Lord stand forever. Only his plans stand forever. Let's keep going. I'm trying to have you understand. Kingdoms are not God. They're not the answer. God is God and God alone. Amos 3 and 6. Look at this right here. Is a trumpet blown in a city and the people are not afraid? Does disaster come to a city unless the Lord has done it? Oh, my God, that ought to make us all tremble. Tremble. Does disaster come to a city, my beloved, unless the Lord has done it? My beloved, I'm trying to get somebody to understand today. Listen, kings and kingdoms are not God. God is God. God has supreme and active, somebody type into the chat, supreme and active authority over all of mankind. God allows the appointments of kings and leaders. It is God who punishes nations by giving them the kings that they deserve, the kings that they cry out for. We want a king. We want Saul. It's God who will punish a nation and give them exactly what they cry for, exactly what they beg for, my beloved. And so let me say it this way again. Israel was telling Samuel and God, we don't want you. We demand a king. We'll take a substitute over you. And my beloved, the Bible says Samuel was actually hurt by it. Hurt by it. Hurt by it. Let's continue to read. I want us to pick up now and pick up from verse 9. God has told him now. See, God told him now. They're not rejecting you, Samuel, but Samuel was hurt. Samuel was troubled by it. He was dismayed by it. But look at verse 9. Listen to them, but solemnly warn them and tell them about the customary rights of the king who will reign over them. Oh, my beloved. Verse 10, Samuel told all the Lord's words to the people who were asking him for a king. Verse 11, he said, these are the rights of the king who will reign over you, over your picking, over your substitute. This is how your substitute is going to treat you. He will take your sons and put them to use in his chariots or his horses or running in front of his chariots. He will appoint them for his use as commanders of thousands or commanders of 50s. He's talking about army there, to plow his ground and reap the harvest, or to make his weapons of war and equipment for his chariots. Look at 13. He can take your daughters to become perfumers, cooks, and bakers. Look at 14. He'll take your best friends, your vineyards, your olive orchards, and your best fields, not friends, your best fields, vineyards, and olive orchards, and give them to his servants. Verse 15. He can take a tenth of your grain and your vineyards and give them to his officials and servants. 16. He can take your male servants, your female servants, your best young men and your donkeys, and use them for his work. Verse 17, and our final verse before we stop. He can take a tenth of your flocks, and you yourselves can become his servants. And when that day comes, when that day comes, when you get the substitute, when you get what you've demanded, when that day comes, you will cry out because of the king you've chosen for yourselves. But the Lord, oh, here's the part here now. But the Lord will not answer you on that day. My beloved, New Creation Outreach Ministries. They come to Samuel and they insult him. He's been their prophet. He's been their pastor. He's been serving them. And Stephen and Tracy, Samuel was hurt. He was troubled. Anybody ever been church hurt? Anybody, I thought about that as I was preparing this. You know, absolutely, we've all been hurt in the church. But I love, what I want us to get out of this is something I've had to learn. But what I love, my beloved, Phil and Sherry, the Bible says Samuel didn't get on the phone. No, he didn't get on the phone. He didn't call anybody. He didn't cause any mess. He didn't cause any discord. No, my beloved, the Bible says he took his pain to God. And what I want us all to learn here is, I've taught it over and over again, and I've had to live by it myself. When things happen to you in the body of Christ, in the church, you take them to God. You take your lamentations to God. I've had to learn that. I was so blessed to read that because it's something I've had to learn. It's something that the way people will do you and hurt you in the church, you have to get to a place where if you don't get there, it will cause you to stop serving God. It'll cause you to quit on God. And God forbid that we would quit on him. Church, Samuel was hurt, but he teaches us as a servant of God what God requires of us all. You take it to God. My beloved church, ladies, the Bible says when he took it to God, when he cried out to God, God answered him. And my beloved, we already read what God said. My beloved, God gave him an answer because he came, he was hurt, but that's where you take your pain. And God told him, listen, listen, they're not rejecting you, they're rejecting me. Don't get yourself in a tizzy. You're going to have to get over this church hurt. Why? Because there's still work for you to do. We can't quit the church. We don't turn our back on the church. We don't leave from one church and drop in another church because things happen. Things are going to happen. That's the way it is when you're dealing with souls, when you're dealing with human beings. You're not dealing with people who are infallible. We are fallible, my beloved. But God, Kay and Scott, the Bible says God answered and told Samuel what to do. And here's where I need us to really dial in, my beloved church, New Creation, to what God told Samuel. He told Samuel what to do, and we already read it. He told Samuel, now listen, listen, what Israel, when you get this substitute, when you get this substitute, because God was so loving, God wanted to tell them what was going to happen to them. And so, my beloved, because God loved Israel, and this is his love coming out. When you read these verses in 9 through 18, you see the love of God. You see, it's not just a warning, but it's God trying to keep them from, you know, they're rejecting him. They're turning their back on him. They're shifting away from him. And yet, because we serve a God who loves us unconditionally, he's still extending his hand. He's still extending. He's still trying to save them from the trouble that they're asking for. Do you know how tough that is to be a pastor trying to really help people and you can't want for them what they don't want for themselves? Do you know how hard that is to try to be loving, always extending the grace of God and the love of God when people will be all around you saying all manner of things, sowing all manner of discord, lying? Do you know how hard that is? The only thing that you can do is just remember, obey God, because God knows he's in every place. And so, my beloved, I'm saying let's learn from him. Learn from this situation. God is extending his love. God is saying, now, Samuel, you go ahead on, and I want you to tell them. I want you to tell them. And here's the thing that I want to make sure that we understand. What they also had forgotten about, my beloved, Pops and Mama Jane, Mama Diana, what Israel had also forgotten about was the covenant that God had established with them as a holy nation. Look up here. See, look up here, and look what it says here by James Garfield, the 20th president. Now more than ever before, the people are responsible for the character of their Congress. If that body is corrupt, ignorant, or reckless, it's because of the people tolerating ignorance, recklessness, and corruption. God was trying to tell them, you are getting ready to, in those verses, God said, you're getting ready to have some ignorance, you're getting ready to be run over. You're getting ready to be abused and mistreated. But they were going to put up with it. They were going to tolerate it. But look up here. They forgot, my beloved, that God had established a covenant with them, which was a theocracy. Theocracy, what is theocracy? Theocracy, you guys know it. It means to be ruled by God. It means that God is the supreme authority and power. Theos, meaning God. Ocracy, meaning government, the government of. They forgot the covenant that they were supposed to be a holy nation, my beloved. A theocracy is what they were supposed to be. But what they were saying to God, we want a monarchy. We want one king, one ruler. We want a form of government where we have one person over us telling us where to get up, get off, and treating us however he wants. That's the substitute that they were asking for. Somebody type it in the chat. There's no substitute for God. And so, my beloved, as we look here, what they forgot, and let's keep going. Let's keep going. Look at 1 Samuel here. It says, we want to be like the nations around us. Give us a king to judge and lead us. But here's what I want us to dial in on right here, my beloved. God gives nations who reject him the kings or the leaders they deserve. God, Mike, gives nations who reject him the kings, the leaders they deserve. Y'all did pick up on what God told Samuel, right? Give them what they want. Y'all did pick up on that, right? Give them what they want. And God will do it every time. If you don't want to follow me, if I'm not good enough, if you want to pick a substitute over me, you can have whatever you want on the menu. Oh, my God, my beloved God, and my saints of God. What I want us to understand here, there is no substitute. But Israel was not supposed to follow after kings and kingdoms. Follow kings and governments. No, my beloved, they were never supposed to turn their back on God. They were saying, we don't want you, Samuel, and we don't want God. What we want a substitute in his place. Oh, my God, that just shows you how they were. That's why they were on and on. That's why God said they were like a thorn in his side from the day that he pulled them out, that he took them out of Egypt. They were like a thorn, on and on and on, never wanting to follow God, always picking substitutes, always. That's what the world is like today. We got Christians who can't get right because they are continually putting a man, putting a woman, putting a homosexual, putting somebody in the place of God. That's why God is saying it's not until the church will turn from her wicked ways that I'll heal the land. And so, my beloved, look up here. One more slide. Hosea 8:4 says, they set up kings, but not from me. See, they did that without my permission. They did that without my blessing. They have made princes or removed them without consulting me. Therefore, I knew and did not recognize them. That's what God was telling them here in these verses, my beloved. I'm not going to recognize anything that you do now. Why? Because the wages of sin is death. And my beloved, we are living in a society with kings and kingdoms, governments who reject God, don't want to have nothing to do with God, who are ignoring God. And we're suffering after all these months. You know, the church, I know many of you have been praying. I've been praying, Lord, maybe this will be a turning point. Maybe there'll be people that begin to cry out to you. And when the deaths start mounting up, you know, I was, nothing's changing. You know, you stop the sports, you stop all of that, and they just continue to pursue ways that they could play pinochle or play something at home, play Jackson, play. They just continue to look for ways, look for substitutes instead of turning to God. And then as the deaths continue to mount up, John and Jackie, then I begin to think, Keith and Dorothy, I begin to think when it started to hit the kids, I say, oh, this is going to be the turning point. This is going to be the turning point. When the kids start dying, everybody going to cry out to God. Didn't happen. Did not happen. And that as of today, we're over 235,000 people who are dead. And they're expecting another 100,000 between now and February. My. We're seeing the same thing, my beloved, in our 21st century, in our time today. Kings and kingdoms. When you want something, when you reject, when you ignore God. That's what we have today. With all this going on, you would think that the men and women that we have put in Congress, you would think that they would come together. But you know why they won't? Because they're pompous. You know why they won't? Because they're taking bribes. You know why they won't? Because they have their own agendas. They have forgot. Kings and kingdoms are not God. God is God. And so, my beloved, we're in trouble this morning. The world is in trouble. And so, my beloved, I want us to look, Mama Kay, I want us to look at, again, based on the demand for a substitute for God, holy God, I want us to look out now at the last 3-4 verses. Look at verse 19. Follow along with me as I read. And we're not going to be much longer. Look at verse 19. The people refused to listen to Samuel. No, they said, we must have a king over us. We demand a king. Verse 20, then we'll be like all our friends, all the other sinful nations. We'll be like all the other pagan nations. Our king will judge us, go out before us, and fight our battles. Listen to the ignorance. Listen to the pride. Listen to the pompous attitude that we have in our world today, that we have in our Congress today, that we have leading in different places today, leading our nation. Verse 21, Samuel listened to all the people's words and then repeated them to the Lord. But look what God said in verse 22. Listen to them. Listen to them, Samuel. You have a concern. You're still in your feelings. You're still kind of bothered and it's broken. Your heart's broken over there rejecting me and rejecting you. But he says, listen to them and give them a king. Fast, final verse. Then Samuel told the men of Israel, each of you go back to your city. You will get a king. And we all know that that king was Saul. We all know that. But my beloved, as we move through this and get ready to close, I want to share just a few more things with you. My beloved church, again, when we read those scriptures, did you listen to the Spirit of God that was telling Samuel, don't worry about it? God was talking to him in such a sweet voice now. Listen to them. No. Don't get upset. Listen. And my beloved, I want you to listen to the Spirit of God and your pastor right now. If you don't want what God wants for you, God will give you whatever you want. Whatever you want. Whatever you, if it's not on the menu, God will get it for you. Whatever you want. If you don't want what he wants for you. And here's what we need to understand. Here's what the world needs to get. Here's what the atheist needs to get. Here's what the politicians and the kings and kingdoms, here's what they don't understand, but it is what they believe about God. What they believe is God is not God. They don't believe God is God. The atheist doesn't believe God is. Kings of nations and kingdoms, politicians, governments, they don't believe that God is in control. They don't believe God exists. My, what a foolish people. Israel right here was proving how foolish they were. And that's why many today reject Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Savior of the world. Sister Roslyn, what the world doesn't know about God is that God is God. Oh, I know y'all got that now. It's been a simple teaching. God is God. Don't ever forget that. There's no substitute for God. God is infinite. He's the creator of the universe. All power and authority absolutely belongs to him. We learned that in week two. Everything belongs to God. I don't care how people feel. I don't care what you say. Everything belongs to God. And the reason, I thought about it. The reason, my beloved, the reason God kicked Satan and a third of the angels out of heaven was because of what Satan had believed. He didn't believe God was God. And he said, you know what? I can be you. I can be a substitute. And because he believed that foolishness, God said, well, I'll show you. I'm going to kick you out. And then I'm going to put you on a clock. I'm going to put you on a clock that there's going to be a tick. Every tick, every day that goes by is a day that's going to be closer to your final place in Sheol, in hell, where you're going to burn eternity, live in eternity. And so he decided, so what did Satan do? He says, I can be you. I can be a substitute here in heaven. And God says, no, you cannot. And so, my beloved, as I move down to this page and get us out of here, Barry and Sybil, what Israel would find out is what the world, kings and kingdoms, are going to find out. Because the Bible tells us every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess one day, then soon and very soon, that Jesus Christ is Lord. God is God. And so, my beloved, what this means for God's people, Pastor, what's it mean for us? I'm telling you now, here's what it means for us. My beloved, we've got to live like we know that. We've got to live like we know better, my beloved, because we know there is no substitute for God. What are we supposed to do? Stephen and Tracy, we've got to light up the world. We've got to salt the world and declare God is God. And there's no substitute for him. We've got to declare it. Somebody type it in the chat. No substitute for Father God. No substitute. We've got to light up the world, Michael. We've got to salt up the earth because we are the light, because we have tasted, because we do know there is no substitute for God. And wonder, sadly, God wanted Israel to love him because they knew he was God. Somebody get it. That is right there. God wanted Israel to love him because they knew he was God. They knew who he was. Don't you know, my beloved, that's why we love God, because we know who he is, because we've tasted and seen that he's good, because we know he's Jehovah Jireh. He's our provider. We ought to know that. But tragically, they rejected him. Israel rejected him. Is anybody, I wonder, rejecting God this morning? There's no substitute for El Shaddai. El Shaddai, the Lord God Almighty. There's no substitute for God. There's no substitute, my beloved, for El Elyon, the Most High God. There's no substitute, my beloved, for Adonai. He's called Lord and Master. There is no substitute for God. Because why? Because God is God. And that's what the world just is. It will kill themselves to go to hell, to ignore and deny. And my beloved, I thought about it, Dre, in the 38th chapter of Job. God had to tell Job, where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me, Job, do you understand who marked off the dimensions? Surely you know. God told him, who stretched the measuring lines across the earth? On what were its footings set? Who laid the cornerstone while the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for me? Where were you? See, there are people today, my beloved, they don't believe God. They don't believe God is God. In new creation, there is a conclusion of the matter of this Zion's Hill or Capitol Hill. My beloved, as I wrap this thing up, here's what we got to make sure we understand, that there is, again, no substitute for God. God is God, and the body of Christ has one God and one King. Look up here. See, God, and here's what I was telling you a few minutes ago. God, while Israel was demanding a substitute, God gave the prophet Samuel some conditions that they so they could have what they wanted, a substitute. He told him, the king that you have, I'm going to give you a king, but he must be under the supreme authority of me. What does he tell him? He says, I'm going to give you a king, but you need to understand, he's got to be subject to following and implementing and leading you in the laws that I set forth. What else did he say? He said, I'm going to give you a king, but he's going to have to serve you. His job is going to be to serve you, the people. But we all know that with all that God's efforts, what he did, that the king that they got, Saul that they got, he didn't do any of that. God was still trying to work with them, compromise. Look up here. Let me show you. I put it out here. I wanted to type what those verses were saying in verses 9 to 18. See, God told Israel, he says, now you tell them how their substitute is going to serve and lead them. You tell them. And so in these verses, God had Samuel tell him, he's going to pervert and you're going to get a perverted and corrupt leadership. He's going to be an abuser and a taker from you. This substitute you want. God said he's going to tax you. He's going to abuse you with taxes. He's going to abuse your freedoms. Look what God told him. There's going to be military wars. Y'all read it. I just broke it down in another way. There are going to be wars and trouble, and your young folks are going to have to go to these wars. They're going to oppress your families. They're going to oppress your young folk, your kids, your children, your daughters, your sons and daughters. People, he says, instead of the king serving you, you're going to serve the government. These are all the things that God was telling him in these verses, Tina. Look what God told him. Where politics is concerned, there's going to constantly be conflict, dissension, and division that's going to rule the day. All these are things that are happening today in our world, happening today with our leaders in Congress, happening today in our government. Perversion, abuse, oppression. Remember, we learned in week one, in week two, they're supposed to be the ministers. They're supposed to minister to us. That's the furthest thing from their mind. God says, this is what kings and kingdoms look like today. When you choose them over me, when you want a substitute instead of wanting me as your savior. And so, my beloved, the conclusion of the matter of Zion's Hill or Capitol Hill, the church has one king. It's God on Zion's hill. Psalm 2 and 6 says, I have set my king firmly on my holy hill of Zion. Look up here. Zion, the church has one king. And Zion's hill speaks about a refuge and a fortress for God's people. It represents Jerusalem, God himself. Zion hill represents the place for God's presence, his protection, and provision. This is why we choose God. This is why we have to light up the world. This is why we have to salt the earth. Listen, it says that God, Zion's hill is the place where spiritual power resides. Is anybody lacking anything this morning? You got to call on God. You got to call on the God, the one God, the King of Kings. God, Zion's Hill is the place where God's people are supposed to do what? It's the spiritual kingdom. It's where we're all going to dwell together. In the sweet by and by. And so, my beloved, is there anybody today listening? You might be visiting for the first time or the fifth time, but you have not experienced the real thing, the authentic God. Why? Because you've been picking substitutes in the place of God. You've been choosing a substitute here and a substitute there. Money and material possessions, sexual immorality. There's somebody today, you were the woman because the devil lied to you and told you that it was a woman that would know how to make you feel. There was a woman that would know how to be sensitive to you. But as you listen today and you've known before today, that's a lie. That's a lie. For somebody else, you sex and drugs and partying, that's been your thing. That's been your substitute for God. But the Lord sent you by New Creation Outreach Ministries online today, digitally, to tell you that's a lie. It's time for you to choose the real thing. It's time to stop rejecting and ignoring me. Because you've been looking for love in all the wrong places. And so, my beloved, as I close this morning, look up here one last time. The church has one king. God is God. Because the church, and the church, because of that, the church will never substitute Father God. Because of that, because God is God, the church never argues and gets emotionally wrapped up in political parties or platforms. Because God is God, the church only has one choice when voting, and that voting has to have an alliance and allegiance to one party, Christ the King. And so, my beloved, who's ready for the real thing this morning? Who's ready for the real thing this morning? Who's tired of substitutes, trying to pick substitutes, and you haven't had any peace? And there's a song that I want to hear now that says, nothing else. The song says, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm sorry for those things that I did. Listen to the song. It's a song of repentance. It's a song of confession for wrong.
I'm caught up in your presence.
Against God. Sinning against God.
I just
turning our back on God.
On your feet.
I just want to sit here. Listen to the song.
Caught up in this holy.
Holy.
Moment.
Uh-huh.
I never
want to leave. That's what we have to do, my beloved. We got to get to the place where we don't ever turn our back on God.
Blessings.
Jesus, you don't owe me anything.
Jesus, you
thank
don't
you,
owe me anything.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
More than anything.
It's time for many. It's time for many in the house of God to repent.
I just want
it's time for many in the house of God who have made other things and persons, little gods, you've put them in place of God.
I'm sorry.
You've said, this is going to take
I'm
your place, God.
Gone through the motions.
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry.
Is anybody crying out this morning? Is anybody
when
repenting?
I just sang another song.
When I've been carnal in my
to where we
decisions, carnal in my ministry,
I
and carnal in my service.
Up my heart.
Father, I cry out to you. I'm sorry. Somebody needs to repent this morning.
I'm sorry.
My God, my God.
When I've come with my agenda, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. Lord,
when
forgive
I
me.
I forgot that you're enough. Take me
Israel
back to
needed
where we
to
start.
Repent.
I
but they were so caught up.
Heart.
They were so busy rejecting God, just like our world today.
I'm caught up in your presence.
Uh-huh, yes,
I just want to sit here at your feet.
Does anybody just want to sit at his feet?
I'm caught up in this
moment. Does anybody just want to sit at his feet?
Moment.
Is there anybody your ministry hasn't moved yet because you put other things in front of God? You have not obeyed God. You haven't got up. You haven't moved.
For blessings.
Because of the substitutes that you are serving.
Jesus, you don't owe
God
me
loves you
anything.
Just like he loved Israel. He was trying to help them.
And more than
keep them from turning their back on him.
You can do.
He wanted Israel to love him because they knew him.
You.
I wonder, is anybody, do you know God this morning? Do you know God this morning?
Oh, I just want you.
Mm-hmm.
And nothing else.
Nothing else.
And nothing else.
Nothing else.
Nothing else.
Until you get to that point in your life where
I just
nothing
want
else
you
matters.
And nothing else.
It's not about the dollars. It's not about sex. It's not about things. It's not about places. It's not about careers.
I just want you,
God. Nothing else. Nothing else.
Nothing else.
Oh, how God longs for us to want him. But I'm so glad that he's not the kind of God that would force himself on us, that he has given us a free will. What kind of love would it be for a husband to make his wife love him? What kind of love would it be for a wife to make a husband love him? Have to be chasing him all the time and chasing her all the time and trying to buy her love. That's not the way God wants it, my beloved. I just want you, nothing else. Nothing else, my beloved. Nothing else.
Nothing else would do.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. It's time for somebody to start over. It's time for you to start over. And the beauty of it is, you can start over with God. That's the beauty of the grace of God, the love of God.
Coming back to where we start.
That looks beyond our faults. Looks beyond our faults, our sins, our rejection of him. And supplies us with need and grace. I'm so glad for the grace of God. That there's nothing that I can do that he'll turn his back on me. Nothing you can do that he'll turn his back on you. That is the love and grace of God.
I'm caught up in your presence.
And I would say to you, my beloved, those that are listening, you might be sitting in Texas somewhere. You might be in Florida somewhere. You might be in Mississippi somewhere where we have folks in those places, in Chicago, listening in. And you know that there have been many a things and things. It might be just one thing that you have put as a substitute in front of God.
And oh, I'm not here for blessing.
I want you to type it in the chat. Lord, forgive me. Don't be ashamed.
Jesus, you don't.
There might be somebody listening. You're ready to turn from all those other substitutes and back to God. You can repent. You can cry out to God. What I want you to do is I want you to go to NCOMLV.church. Go to NCOMLV.church. Go to our website. Go to the prayer and type it in the chat. I need prayer. I need prayer. There may be somebody, again, you've been visiting with us online. You might be local. You might not be local. You might be from another state. But you don't have a church home. And the Spirit of the Lord says, connect yourself with this church. Connect yourself with this teaching church. Until I tell you otherwise, just obey God. We'll nurture you. We'll love on you. We'll help you in every way. But it's time for somebody to make that decision. Make that decision that you want God more than anything else. You just want God. Father, I thank you for this time today. I thank you for your word today. Your word is a lamp unto our feet. It's a light unto our path. Father, I thank you, Lord, that over these 4 weeks of teaching, we've gotten closer to you. I thank you, Lord, in these 4 weeks of teaching in this mini-series, that we are wiser, that our decisions, our emotions, we're going to be more in control of them. We're not going to be allowed and emotionally driven and angered by political parties and platforms. We're going to vote up and down the ballot the Bible. That means we have no allegiance to one party over another. We're just going to simply vote, as we learned 2 weeks ago. We're going to vote the word of God, and we're going to leave the rest to you. You bring up kings, you bring them down. Whatever decision you make, oh God, we're going to be happy with it because we trust you. And so I thank you today, my Father, and all of New Creation Outreach Ministries. Thank you for tuning in today. We so love you. I'm looking forward to seeing you this afternoon in the pastor's chat at 5 o'clock. God bless you. Have a great day and a great week. And don't forget, vote Tuesday. God bless you.
Hi, welcome to New Creation Outreach Ministries. We are so glad that you joined us today. If you've just watched the Preach Word and you've decided that you'd like to give your life to Christ, I want you to say this prayer with me. Heavenly Father, I know I'm a sinner. I know I am not where I want to be in life. I believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross to pay the ultimate price for my sins. Come in and cleanse me of all sin, shame, and guilt. I invite Jesus Christ to be my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. If you've just said that prayer, you've been born again. I encourage you to put God first in your life. Read your Bible and start a prayer life. Here at New Creation Outreach Ministries, we have a number of classes to help you get started on your walk with Christ. You can locate them on our website at NCOMLV.church. That's NCOMLV.church. Now that you have Jesus, don't forget to share him with someone else. On behalf of New Creation Outreach Ministries, we love you and have a blessed week.